Raúl, who is our next speaker from the Universidad de Granada in Spain. He's going to talk about Brownian particles in electro-optical traps. So go ahead, Raúl.
Okay. Let me see. Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Hello?
Yeah.
And my pointer as well?
Yes.
Is it moving? Okay, good. So thank you very much. So I'm Raúl Rica, as I told you, from the University of Granada. I just built a new lab that we call the Nanoparticle Trapping Lab. It is in the Department of Applied Physics, I put it in Spanish. So it's in the Department of Applied Physics of the University of Granada. And here we basically, what we do is to work with Brownian particles in traps. What do I mean with a trap? A trap is basically a parabolic potential, as you see, it looks like you don't see my pointer. You do? I don't see my pointer, I'm sorry. Okay, you see there is a parabolic potential that is described by the potential V that I show here, and it is in principle parabolic in all three dimensions of space. And the origin of this potential can be either can be due to different types of interactions. In this talk, I will talk about both electrical forces, electrostatic forces, and optical fields. Optical fields are created by gradients of laser light. And here, what you see is a nanoparticle. In this case, it's a nanodiamond, 100 nanometers in diameter, that is levitated by an electrostatic potential, and you see it thanks to the interaction with a tightly focused laser. So the bright spot that you see is a laser that is focused exactly where the nanoparticle is located, and what you see is the scattering from the particle. Well, we are doing it in the, as I told you, in my new lab. The work started 1 year ago, as you see on the upper left picture, and the work finished in back in December. We started to install the equipment in January, but yeah, after the lockdown, we've been closed for almost 3 months. But today we have a lab that is starting to work. So my talk today will not be about results, because we don't have any results yet, but we are just trying to fix technical problems, technical issues. We are working on two new experiments, and I will explain a little bit what we want to do with these two experiments and the applications we are looking for. As I said, we work with traps, and in a trap you basically have a parabolic potential that establishes a system that is basically a Brownian harmonic oscillator. In the first equation you see here is just the equation of the harmonic oscillator as it is typically written down. You first have inertia and the mass times acceleration. Then you have a damping term that is proportional to the velocity. And then you have a term that is given by the field, that is the is described as a linear spring. And then on the right, we put Brownian white noise that describes that in principle incorporates any noise source in the system. We also define the damping rate, that is the fraction of the damping and the mass, and in this case we typically write the Brownian harmonic oscillator equation in the as you see in the second row. Typically, we will work in either water or air, and in these two cases, the harmonic oscillator is in the overdamped region. This is a classical approximation, and this is valid in many situations, but not always. But in principle, you can, for example, in optical tweezers, as is the most common experimental setup, it is completely valid in many, many situations. And the good thing with the optical tweezers is that we can not only trap the particle, but we can also track the position of the particle with very high precision. So what you see here, the you see time traces of the position as a function of time, and these are real measurements. You see we have three lines, black, blue, and red, and these are for three different laser powers. And as you increase the laser power, you somehow increase the confinement of the particle, and you see that what happens with the black curve. You also see that the distribution of positions, that is these Gaussian curves you see on the right, also is made thinner.
Raul, what's the particle made up of?
So in this experiment, it's just polystyrene, 1 micron size polystyrene. But in optical tweezers in liquid, you can basically trap dielectric particles or metallic particles. Other types of particles give troubles, but there are also some ways to fix it. But okay. I will show some results with other particles. Give me a second. Okay, so we typically also study the trajectory in terms of the power spectral density, that is something like the squared of the Fourier transform of the trajectory. And you see on the top right figure, you see three power spectral densities of these three trajectories, and you see that as you increase the laser power, you both increase the characteristic frequency of the trap, and you also decrease the space the particle explores. So you decrease the value, the low value of the plateau, the low frequency plateau of the distribution. Okay, so this is standard in optical tweezers, and with this tools, basically the trap and the detection of the motion, you can have access to many to a lot of information about the processes that are going on with the particle. This is standard, and there's a lot of bibliography. What we are doing now here is working on two setups. The first one is optical tweezers in suspension in liquid, that's it, is standard, but I will also talk about another kind of traps that is done with electrical forces, and in this case we will talk about levitation, because the trapping is not done in liquid but is done in air. The optical tweezers were invented by Arthur Ashkin, and we had the Nobel Prize awarded for him in 2018. And the mechanism behind optical tweezers is well known, and it is it was thanks to the radiation pressure of light. Light also can transfer momentum to particles, and if you have, as I show here in the first picture, if you have a laser that points from left to right, you will push particles along the direction of propagation of the particles of the laser beam, thanks to the radiation pressure, that is the so-called scattering force. And you can use two counter-propagating lasers to counteract the scattering force, and you get a trapping position at the center or at the focus of both lasers, as you see in the second figure on the left. And if you use a very tightly focused laser beam, you can trap with only one laser. But yeah, there are many things to fix to do it. But basically, two forces appear. One is the gradient force that points towards the maximum of light intensity. You see the F grad is proportional to the gradient of intensity. And there is also the scattering force that pushes the particles along the direction of propagation of the particles. Okay? I've been working in optical tweezers for a while already. And there are some previous works that I did on stochastic thermodynamics with Edgar. Well, we were both working at IFFO. Some of you may know these works. But yeah, this is old stuff, and I would like to show what we are doing now here in Granada. We already built up optical tweezers where we can have several traps. You see here I have 6 traps, and I am switching them on and off. Here I put too many particles in suspension, and you see that in a single trap you can trap many particles. So if you want to do precise measurements, you should reduce the concentration of particles. But one good thing we achieved is that, yeah, we have many particles, so we can study interactions between particles, and we can measure all the trajectory of every individual particle with very high sampling, right? With very high sampling, right? We are also now working with particles inside droplets. So you hear there is a big droplet. It is something like 40 microns, and I'm here using two traps. With one trap, I'm trapping a particle inside the droplet, and with the other trap, I'm moving around the droplet. Let me show you the video again. You see here, I'm moving the particle inside the droplet, and now I start to move the droplet without moving the particle. You see there are quite flexibility here. We want to somehow study confinement effects inside the droplets. But yeah, this is only ongoing work so far. We are also working with plasmonic particles. As I told you at the beginning of my talk, you can also trap metallic nanoparticles, like gold nanoparticles, with a very small size. And as Ali told us before, if you shine gold nanoparticles with the right wavelength, these nanoparticles will lead to plasma resonances, where there is a lot of absorption of the radiation, and you will have a plasma resonance, as you see here. In the far field, these effects are responsible for the bright full colors that you see with colloidal suspensions of metallic nanoparticles. But more interestingly, in the near field, what you get is that you have very strong electric fields that are highly confined, way below the diffraction limit. And also you see you have a strong release of heat. For some time, this heat release has been thought as a problem, but this can also be used to do different things. For example, you can, in a microchannel or a nanochannel, you can induce convection thanks to gradients in temperature. You can, as we saw before, also you can try to treat cancers by irradiating some parts of a body where you have a cancer, or you can also create convection around individual particles, as you see in the two plots on the right hand side of the slide. So a couple of years ago, we demonstrated that the combination of these gradients of temperature with an electric field leads to a very efficient convection, because you may want to heat up your sample, but maybe not too much. And in this paper in ACS Nano that you see up here, they demonstrated that only with a gradient of temperature you cannot induce a strong convection in microchannels. And this is a problem, but we demonstrated that strong convection can be obtained with small gradients of temperature. Here we were working with something like 5 degrees about room temperature. And these small gradients of temperature combined with an electric field leads to a very high convection that is important many times or in many applications in microfluidics. So this is the work we did some time ago, but now we are working on this kind of effects, but in a more local regime. We are going to trap a single gold nanoparticle. We will irradiate it with a laser beam to heat up, and we will also apply an electric field to induce this very strong convection around it, and we want to characterize it and try to use it as a way of creating flow at the micro nano scale. This is something that we are working on already. And that was all for the optical tweezer setup that I told you. Let me now discuss about the second setup we are building, that is a pole trap. A pole trap is a trap that is created with an electric field. But there is the trapping here is not that straightforward, because of Laplace equation, you cannot build a potential that is stable in all three dimensions of the space. Because as you see here, if you consider a potential that is quadratic in all terms, Laplace equation imposes that at least in one direction of space, the potential will be unstable. Okay, so in principle, your trap, your potential will be a shadow potential, and you cannot trap simultaneously in all three dimensions of space. Then you have to play a trick, it's something like this. You take your shadow potential and you rotate it. And in this case, you get to a stable trapping. This is a mechanical simile that we built in our lab for students, but this is the idea. And then what you find is that the motion is somehow more complicated. The system is not in complete equilibrium because these are driving, but we recently demonstrated that the Brownian dynamics of a particle in a pole trap is very similar to what you would expect for an optical trap, for example. There are some differences, but in the end, it works almost the same, so it is also a good system to explore. And in fact, we have already built a pole trap, and you see here we can also track the position of the particle with high sampling rate. We have also a distribution that is Gaussian, that it, as it, it is expected to for equilibrium system, and the power spectral density also is similar to what is expected. There is some noise in the system. We still are struggling with the electronics in the system, but yeah, we are working on it. On the right hand picture, you see there is a small spot between two cones that are two electrodes. What you see there is a 1 micron size particle that is shining thanks to a laser beam. But what you see here is what you see in the experiment. If you look with the night eye, so these experiments are also quite beautiful because you can really see the bright spot with your naked eye. And it's also nice. Students are always happy to see things with naked eyes. We are also trapping aerosol droplets. Here, I show you there is a nebulizer that is, this is from Omron, that is a nebulizer that we use, you can buy for inhalating some drugs. And with this, we generate droplets. As you see here, we have the two cones, and we generated a lot of droplets. And the pole trap allows us to trap a lot of them. And here, we are now decreasing the potential to try to have only one droplet. Here, you have two. Now, you have only one. And now, what we do is to defocus the image. And here, there appear some bright and dark strips. As you see here, this is the same. The good thing here is that there is some interference pattern inside the droplet. So there is interference with the light that is incoming into the droplet. There is some transmission and there is some reflection. So there is a interference with the light that is incoming and the light that is reflected. And then you get these bright and dark fringes. And these fringes provide an interferometric way of measuring with very high precision the size of the droplet you have trapped. So this has a lot of applications in aerosol science, and we are also interested in these things.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You have just 2 minutes more that we can use for.
Okay. Okay, then I'll finish right now. This is just another trap that we built where you can trap a row of particles. As you can see, we can study interactions. And just to finish, we are also building hybrid traps where we combine pole traps and optical traps, and we have these fancy potentials where there's some bistabilities and some improved performance in some cases. We also build this and measure the potential distribution. Yeah, that's all. With this I finish. We are interested in many things. We will be happy to collaborate with theoreticians and people that do simulations. And yeah, with this I thank my colleagues and you for your attention.
Thanks a lot for this very interesting talk. So we have time for one question.
Okay, maybe. Juan, I know you work very well, but on top of that, there's this thing you said about the gold nanoparticle is somehow related to what Ali Rajapur was talking about this morning. So, yeah. How do you plan to measure the heat So you put in this map. So would you be able to measure the temperature in the fluid near the heated nanoparticle?
Well, there are some tricks that could be played to do it. One would be, as I show you here, to have one trap that is the one particle that is trapped in one trap that is gold, and this releases heat. And then I have another particle trapped with another trap, and this particle is dielectric. And from the fluctuations of this particle around this one, if there is some heat release, you will feel these fluctuations with this second particle. And that's a way of measuring that. And there are also other ways that you can use some molecules that...
So you can apply the Kimoto's formula in the second particle and measure the heat out of it.
Yeah.
Nice. Amazing. Okay.
Okay, so thanks a lot. I give you an applause in the name of everyone. It was a really interesting talk. Now we move to our next speaker of the day, who is Duma Dick Hartmann from the Université Marienne en Guavi in Congo. And the title of the talk is Computational X-ray Spectroscopy,